What did you see, old man?
Godzilla. Godzilla. Godzilla.
This week, we're setting the popcorn time machine back to May 20th, 1998, piling up thousands of fish in the street and luring out the one and only Godzilla. Back in New York for the second week in a row, but this time we're doing more damage than that goddamn thing did. Call the worm guy, get the army in the streets, and can somebody lock on those missiles because he looks angry. And we are back. Another episode of Popcorn Time Machine. We are here to rewatch, rewind, and react to all those movies from the 80s and 90s that you know and love. And this week, we'd figure we'd get you all ready for the new Godzilla, X-Kong, New Empire 37, whatever movie they're on right now, get you ready for it. But we are, of course, going over Godzilla from 1998, that kaiju action in your face summer pop popcorn blockbuster, getting all tongue-tied here directed by Roland Emmerich.
You're that excited?
I'm so excited. He is Roland Emmerich, the disaster film maestro himself. You know him from Independence Day, Day After Tomorrow. This is starring Matthew Broderick, Gene Reno, Maria Patillo, Hank Azaria, and a couple other people from The Simpsons. But of course, I cannot operate this popcorn time machine alone. So with me, I have Kevin.
Hello, hello.
Diaz.
Yo, yo, yo.
We got Jimmy. And of course, we have Sil.
What it's up?
So I figured a fun little question for everybody before we get into this whole Godzilla nonsense is, Godzilla is attacking the city. What are you doing? Are you running? Are you hiding? Are you fighting? Are you trying to document this thing? Where do you fall in line with Godzilla? Knowing what you know, knowing the movies you've seen, what are you doing? What are you going to try to do? Jimmy, you're our kaiju enthusiast, so let's let you lead the way, because this is, you know, spoiler alert by Jimmy's toys. Those are not his only Godzilla toys. He cannot fit all the other Godzilla toys in the screen. If he did, you'd only see Godzilla. this episode is very Jimmy centered, so get ready for the Godzilla knowledge you didn't know you needed. So yeah, Jimmy, what are you doing with Godzilla?
I'm very excited about this episode. I'm definitely running. I'm running. Just from what I've known over the last 69 years, yeah, I'm running.
So Godzilla's stomping through the streets. Where are you going? Who are you gonna call? Oh wait, that was last week.
Oh wait, yeah. No, I'm with Jimmy. I'm running. I'm probably gonna be petrified and paralyzed, and you know, not run too far. But I will try my best to just run.
Diaz, you know New York from New York. What are you doing with Godzilla in New York?
I understand you guys wanting to run, but how do you run from a? Like, how many feet is Godzilla? How do you run from that? Someone that can knock over buildings. I ain't running. I'm hiding my ass off. I'm in the subway.
Yeah.
Reason why, if he's running through the city, that means the ground hasn't given away yet. I'm going underground.
Yeah.
Keyword, it is what it is. I'm going to try to go underground.
Oof. Kevin, where are you going for Godzilla?
Well, apparently, while Godzilla is wiping out the city, there was two businesses open. The pharmacy and that pub they were in trying to put the news on the TV. So I'm going to that pub because it's the only thing open in the city.
Here's that.
Yeah, I mean, if you pick fighting, like, who are you kidding? Like, what am I gonna do? Throw a rock at him? Like, he's not gonna do. But I'm gonna document this one. I don't know if I'm gonna, like, because nobody ever runs away from these places. These, you know, the traffic's backed up. You know, everything's closed. Apparently, the airport wasn't closed in this movie either because he was going to the Newark airport.
Well, they technically evacuated the city.
Yeah, they said,
unless you run the pharmacy or you're in that pub with all those people shooting pool and watching TV, everybody else needs to evacuate.
Those are the essential
employees.
Yeah.
Employees.
But I mean, there's no way I'm going to try to run
without a vaccine.
Then I'm just going to be in traffic.
Where do you run? I guess where do you go?
The last place I'm going to die is the last place is going to be in traffic. I already hate being in traffic anyways. Like, I'm not going to die in traffic. So, you know, at least Worst case scenario, I get stomped. Best case scenario, I got some cool pictures to get like famous on Instagram of Godzilla. So let's just give our initial thoughts. You know, we do our rating scale, our popcorn scale at the end, but I guess a good place to start on this is just kind of like your initial thoughts. You know, do you remember when you first saw this? Was this the first time you saw this? You know, I'm curious to see when and where everybody saw this for the first time. But Kevin, what was your viewing experience? If you remember?
I've never been, but not by choice, but I've just never been a Godzilla movie buff. Don't remember seeing really any of them. I remember as a kid, there was this show on the weekends that was called Creature Double Feature, where they'd have these kind of films. So I came into this with no expectations, not holding it to any standard. So we'll go from there. So I don't hold it to any true Godzilla fan standard, but I just totally based it on as a movie watcher.
Now, well, let's go from the non-Godzilla right over to Mr. Godzilla himself. What did you do? Do you remember when you specifically saw this movie? Is this what kickstarted the love, or did you know it beforehand?
Oh, I knew it way beforehand. I think my very first Godzilla film, I think I was
back when you were a kid in like 54.
Yeah. I was in first grade and I went to the video store and I just, I rented Godzilla vs. Biollante, which is a really cool, movie.
Oh, of course. That classic. Everyone knows that.
Actually, it is a popular one. So I remember
in your circles
years later, I went to the movies and it was My Giant with like Billy Crystal. And one of the trailers attached was Godzilla. And I remember watching the trailer and thinking before they showed the title, I was like, oh, this looks like a Godzilla film. And sure enough, like there it was. And I remember just like the promotional stuff that would just kind of,
That trailer was awesome, Jimmy. Yeah. That trailer was sick.
The trailer's great.
Was that the so I remember there was a teaser trailer that they put out a year before this movie came out. Yep. They filmed it. I think it was like $600,000 to film, and it didn't even make it to the movie. But it was just him stomping on a T-Rex skeleton. So like it made you think it was a Jurassic Park movie. And then I was like, nope, here's the king of new dinosaurs, or you know, whatever it's classified as.
That by no means was the only thing that made you think of Jurassic Park in this
movie. No, but they knew what they were doing.
It never crossed my mind.
Before that, I remember, to kick off 1998, I just thought it was like a, you know, just a fun commercial just to celebrate the new year. And I remember the ball was dropping and this giant tail knocks the ball into the crowd. And then just the green glowing print of just Godzilla. And I remember I was so stoked. I didn't know what it meant. I just thought it was a really cool commercial. They added Godzilla in it. And that was it. And then I remember I saw that trailer going to that movie and it was coming out that May, but to me, which was like 6 or 7 months away, but that felt like an eternity. And I saw it with my father. Yeah. I mean, I know a lot of the other Godzilla fans, enthusiasts are not fans of this. It's always had a soft spot, nostalgic movie for me. So yeah, I've always loved it. I always thought it was a fun one. Yeah. Given its flaws.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Syl, have you seen this one before? Or was this a first viewing?
I have a weird relationship with this movie. So, when 1998, I was 5 years old, and then my mom visited the States for the first time ever. We still live back home in Venezuela, and she brought me a bunch of like cool stuff, the American toys, whatever. But she brought me this cup holder that had Godzilla. It was like a massive Godzilla wrapped around.
Oh, the Taco Bell cup?
It could have been. I don't know.
It was a Taco Bell cup.
Of course he knows. It was
a Taco Bell. Jimmy, run to the kitchen and get yours.
Yeah. Show it. Prove it. Well, I don't know if it was a cup because like you couldn't drink out of it. You can only put things inside. So it was hollow. So it may or may have not, whatever. But
I forgot they did a promotion with Taco Bell. That's such a weird. When you think Godzilla, you think a burrito? Like, but go on, yeah. Sir.
That was my first introduction to Godzilla. So I was like, oh, so that's Godzilla. So even though Godzilla's not an iguana, right? I did get that first impression. Like that was Godzilla. So that was the first Godzilla that I encountered. But the movie, no, I just watched it last week, three times. And yeah, I have a lot to say about the movie. It was interesting. It was interesting. I'm gonna talk from the heart, I guess.
We'll get into that.
That's gonna be the general consensus, I'm sure.
Diaz, New York City. Is this how, you know, what did you think of the portrayal in this? How did you like this movie?
I like how they showed the chaos of the city, the different cultures and stuff they showed in the city. I wish they would have showed more like business people in the city, how they would affect, like, imagine Godzilla running down Wall Street. Like, what would they do? Yeah. But being in New York, I lived in New York in that time. So it was more as a kid, I was like, oh, shit, this is happening in my backyard. I know that building. I've seen that place. This, in my head, I was just like amazed that they were going to do it in New York and all that. What threw me off when I first saw the movie, and I remember old Godzilla looked like he had hands to punch. This thing looked like a dinosaur right out the bat.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So it just threw me off on the look of it. I said, did he evolve? Like, I was, as a kid, I didn't know much, but I was like, I wanted to know, was this the Godzilla? Was it a relative of Godzilla? Stuff like that. Like, where was it going? Yeah, because it looked more like a dinosaur than Godzilla to me. But I was just interested to see it destroy shit that I knew.
Yeah. I remember seeing this movie, I think, as a rental, because what really sticks out to me was I remember that VHS cover of the eye, and it was like, it felt cool too, because it was like not a smooth cover. It was textured almost as it scales. So I remember picking that out and being like, ooh, this is cool. Obviously, as a kid, you know, like, it's a Godzilla movie. Like, it's a monster movie. People love it. Like, as a kid growing up, I was scared of it. And I think I'm still waiting for that, you know, proposed stinger that they added to the end of the movie.
This was the first one that was American made, right? Like, this was the introductory to the US or to North America for Godzilla.
Yeah, but I liked it for what it was. You know, I again, much like most of you other than Jimmy, didn't really have a Godzilla attachment prior to this movie. Obviously, you know what Godzilla is, or I did at least, but I never watched a Godzilla movie. So it was something, that's for sure.
Right. Original 1954, right? Was the original. Yes.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Damn, 54?
It's
69, yep, he's about to turn 70.
I think the people behind it, like they said, were influenced a lot by King Kong, which was, I think, the late 30s, right?
Yeah. So it all kind of comes full circle. So Godzilla was, King Kong influenced the Beast from the 20,000 Fathoms, which then influenced Ishiro Honda and those guys to make Godzilla, and they obviously used the, you know, atomic bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki as like inspiration and as like a metaphor of like what, you know, he wasn't just a dude in a rubber suit, but it meant a little more. But it all kind of, as far as kaiju, it all kind of comes back to King Kong, where one took inspiration from the other.
And funny enough, now we get to see him on the big screen again, teaming up in a couple days.
Yeah.
This was an interesting cast. And before we kind of get into our you know, real talk segment, I just curious, Jimmy, you know a lot about this movie. This seems like a very bizarre cast. Not just cast, but like characters too. Like, we need a worm guy, and we need a cameraman, and we need some weird French secret service guy that we don't really fully understand. He's kind of shady, but he's kind of like super suave and cool. Like, it was so not military oriented. The military seemed like an afterthought to our main characters, you know, a failed intern newscaster. So do you know how this cast and crew like came to be at all, and why they chose this direction?
Well, it's interesting too, because you see a lot of like Roland Emmerich films, and especially like Independence Day had three huge, especially two guys really heating up in like Will Smith and Jeff Goldblum, and Bill Pullman was pretty established too, but you had a lot of really famous people. Even like Vivica Fox, Judd Hirsch, like you still had like even the, you know, and then this one kind of has, I mean, Jean Reno is pretty famous for, you know, he had a pretty decent career for a little bit. Matthew Broderick was kind of the most famous one out of all of them.
And then you have Cable Guy.
Cable guy. I mean, still, I mean, even Lion King. And, you know, obviously we all know him for Ferris Bueller's and stuff, but then you have Maria Patillo, who this movie kind of just what we thought would, you know, lend to a promising career. It just never happened. And then Dean Devlin, who's the executive producer, who's teamed up with Roland Emmerich on quite a few films, you know, especially Independence Day. He loved The Simpsons. So, you know, it was an excuse to cast Hank Azaria, Harry Shearer. And then there is a cameo by Nancy Cartwright, who plays Bart Simpson. But the role to Animal at first was going to go to Cuba Gooding Jr.
Oh, jeez.
I could see that.
Yeah.
Cuba Gooding Jr. was up for the role. Matthew Broderick was the first choice. Matthew Broderick, just being attached to Godzilla, he took it sight unseen. Didn't know the script, didn't know the story, but wanted to be part, you know, wanted to be part of it. As far as Maria Patillo, and don't really know anything about her. I tried IMDb-ing her. Her career kind of ended at like 2001.
Well, I can see that after this movie, because I thought she was terrible.
Oh, she gets absolutely roasted by, and you listen to other podcasts, she gets absolutely roasted.
This was not a good showing.
Reno, yeah. the guy that played the French guy, Reno, was this after The Professional or right around the same time? Because The Professional blew him up. Leon the Professional. That was before.
And then I think Ronan. Okay.
Was Ronan before this too?
Yeah, Ronan. Was that with Robert De Niro?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so Ronan, Leon the Professional. Yeah, because that was with Natalie Portman.
Yeah.
So that was, yeah, that was probably
a great fucking, that's a great movie too.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, so that was before.
Okay.
That was before. So John Reno.
Okay.
And Matthew Broderick are probably like weirdly the two biggest stars of this movie. You know, Hank Azaria is more known for voice acting. So this is, but yeah, that would have been interesting. Cuba Gooding Jr. is Animal Palazzi or whatever his last
name is. Definitely a different switch. All right. Well, let's get into real talk, where I kind of broke this movie into chapters again. You know, I think I have it as like five chapters, and they're, for as long of a movie this is, I feel like not a lot really happened. You know, like there was a just a there's standstill stuff, but a lot of it's just like attack. You know, obviously it comes with the nature of the beast in the genre of kaiju monster films. There's going to be a lot of big action sequences and chase scenes and stuff like that, but I really feel like it was just you can kind of block this movie fairly easy. So I kind of had chapter one is just simply setting the stage. You know, we get the title cards where apparently the French nuked a bunch of iguanas and Godzilla was created. I was interested on that. You know, was the only, you know, is it like Highlander? Like there can only be one of Godzilla. There was only one strong iguana that could mutate. There was a bunch of them and they just nuked the shit out of them. So I don't know what the French have against the iguanas, but
you know, what's funny about that. We were saying how did the French people play into that? Take France out of it. If anybody would have caused that, they would have been trying to hide it up. They wouldn't have been admitting that. So.
Well, even
so, I think France actually got in trouble in real life for testing nuclear weapons. I think in the like early 90s, they were testing a nuclear weapons out in like, you know, I think like Bikini Atoll or whatever somewhere, but they were illegally testing nukes. And
but they used all the footage at the beginning were like tests the Americans did like leading up to World War II. So they used all those clips and then got into the movie and blamed it on the French.
The French.
Well, Gareth Edwards, who directed 2014's Godzilla, kind of uses the same montage, but kind of goes back in time to like World War II.
He does.
You know,
makes it make sense a little bit more.
Yeah.
You know, so we just kind of get that, which is a nice little introduction. You know, we didn't need the whole origin story. I did like we get that whole intro of the Japanese shipping or fishing boat, which in case you didn't know, it was a Japanese fishing boat. They made sure to shove that down your goddamn throat with the guy watching sumo while eating noodles with all the headband. It's just like, they're like, you know what stereotypes of Japanese can we kind of plug in here? Yeah, we're just gonna throw them all in.
That scene is straight from The Beast of 20,000 Fathoms. Like, There's some scenes here that are like complete remakes right from that movie.
Well, that's what's interesting, because a lot of people would have said if this wasn't titled Godzilla, this would have been a great remake. And I think reviews would have been way more positive if it was just called The Beast of the 20,000 Fathoms. Yeah.
Like literally the scene where he comes into the fish market in New York is exactly where that movie brings the beast into New York. But
But during this setting the stage chapter, you know, we kind of get our intro of Godzilla. We kind of have an idea of what he's doing. And then we get our introduction of Nick Tatopoulos, the worm doctor, wacky American who is introduced by, you know, driving down the road, singing in the rain, almost crashes into a truck. And then he starts electrocuting worms that are 17% bigger than normal worms. Sure.
From the nuclear fallout, Chernobyl.
Yeah, of course. Which is funny where it's like 17% bigger is... Of course, that's a lot bigger. Like, really, is it? Because
17, it's like,
yeah.
I had a big meal today, and I grew 17%.
But yeah, he has a permit, though.
Yeah, $1.17. Is it really that much more than a dollar?
When did he notice? Oh, that worm looks a little bit bigger than the one I've seen before. That one looks a little bigger too. Let me compare. This one is not 12, not 15. 17% bigger.
Because of a man-made accident, the Chernobyl earthworms are now 17% larger than they were before.
17%, huh? Sounds pretty big.
They're enormous.
Sure. But he gets immediately brought in by the army because, of course, you need the worm guy for Godzilla.
Absolutely.
Investigation. But we get him inside the foothole where it's, well, I don't see the evidence. I don't see the evidence. What? Where's the sample? Where's the sample? Like, oh yeah, you're sitting in the sample. Sorry, buddy. And I know that the scene is after, but it's kind of following the Nick introduction. Spoiler. Where
I like that scene.
The foot scene?
Yeah. You know, it's rumor has it those footprints are still in Panama.
Oh, jeez. One thing I did notice that was funny, all the footprints that you saw are like completely pressed down, right? Like there's no, you know, like you kind of have to climb into it. You saw him climbing out of it, right? With the ladder. They didn't climb into it, though. They were just walking. Walked into the sample, but climbed out. A little continuity error right there, because they would have had to climb into it to climb out of it. But they just walked into it. Did I ruin that scene for you? Sorry.
No.
We're talking about a giant nuclear dinosaur, and you're worried about a ladder? didn't ruin it at all for me.
The next little bit of him is where we see that the remnants of that Japanese fishing container. And, you know, you can see the scale of it. Something is up. The interesting part where he pulled, like, was it like the skin or the gums off of the boat?
Yeah, it's a little bit of flesh. Yeah.
Flesh. Yeah. Jimmy, you could probably answer this. I mean, they shoot the hell out of this thing. Is it going to come off like that? Is his skin that easy to peel off? Like, does he just leave DNA around the evidence scene?
Okay, so this is funny. So when Roland Emmerich and Dean Devlin signed on to this, Toho, who owns the rights, is the owner of the character Godzilla, they gave them a 75-page dossier on the rules of what you can and can't do or with Godzilla.
And then they proceeded to throw it out the window.
So, well, I'll tie that in a sec. So one of it is, you know, he's got to have his dorsal plates. He's got to have, interestingly enough, I learned this. He can't be made fun of in the movie. You can't make fun of the character. He can't eat people, but if he eats something, it's got to be like fish. And he can't die from conventional weapons. Well, obviously, spoilers.
We'll talk about that.
Wow. But,
interesting.
When Roland Emmerich wasn't a fan of the franchise. He actually said that when he was a kid, him and his friends would go to the movies on Saturday when they were showing Godzilla films and make fun of them. You know, he didn't think Godzilla was a fun. He didn't believe in the character. You know, he didn't really care for it. And then when they kept asking him, he finally signed on. But his own one condition was that he can do whatever he wants.
No dossier.
Dossier.
None.
Yeah, it's they definitely strayed a little bit far from the path. And I'm sure that's exactly who you want helming this big project as somebody who used to just make
I think part of the story for me, like learning that he wasn't the original director.
No.
And the two original screenwriters also left. Yep. And when he took over as the, because the original director was going to be like John DeBond.
Yep, Jan DeBond. He had a
Twister. He did Twister, I think.
He had a really cool idea. Yep. Yeah. Twister and Speed.
The two original screen. And then so when the new director, when the new team came on, like they scrapped everything that the originals were doing.
So they still gave Terry.
And I wonder if that played into some of the problems with the some of the critiques that people have about the movie is like it was a complete rework.
Yeah. So the original, it was supposed to be in 94. Jan de Bon had a great idea. The script is actually online where, and Jan de Bont's first two choices for the main characters were Helen Hunt and Bill Paxton, who he ended up using for Twister. And he had a very traditional kaiju flick where actually Godzilla was, I believe, bioengineered by, I think it was the Atlanteans. It was some ancient race, but Godzilla went rogue.
No, you're right. It was the fictitious city of Atlantis that created him. Yep, that's right.
Godzilla goes rogue and wipes out everybody and ends up fighting this alien called the Gryphon, which starts harvesting DNA from other animals on the planet and starts merging together. And it was a very traditional kaiju flick where he was going to, you know, and it was going to take place in New York. Jan de Bont wanted like TriStar wasn't budging for 80 million, like more than 80 million. We'll give you 80 million. Jan de Bont wanted like 100 plus. And they couldn't agree. Jan de Bont leaves to go make Twister. And now they're stuck with who can we find? Well, Independence Day explodes. Independence Day exploded. And they kept asking Roland Emmerich. And Roland Emmerich, after like three or four times, said, you know what? Fine, we'll do it. But we want to do whatever we want with the character. And they agreed. And they gave him a budget, I think, of $125 million plus the $80 million in marketing, because there used to be buses that
huge
would say
campaigns.
His bus or his foot is as big as this bus, his tail is, but it's cool. One little quick thing. So Terry Rossio, who wrote the original Godzilla, he did get story credit for this. Well, there's a storyboard drawing of Godzilla on all fours, and like one of his, you know, he's swiping in the air, and Terry Rossi always wanted Godzilla on all fours. Well, fast forward to 2021, Godzilla vs. Kong, Terry Rossi wrote that. And guess what? He, in that scene where he's looking for Kong in Hong Kong, Godzilla goes down on all fours. So he got to put that idea back, you know, 20 plus years later. So I thought that was really cool how it came full circle.
He's smaller in this one than normal Godzilla movies, right?
He's smaller in different scenes.
Yeah, he's about 165 feet.
Okay. Yeah. How much is he normally?
It varies. So each Godzilla era is made up of like which emperor reigned. So from 54 to 74 is called the Showa era, and he's usually about 50 meters tall. Then from 89 to 92 is the Heisei era, which is 100 meters tall, so he's about over 300 feet. And then this one, they shrunk him back down to about 160 feet, so a little over 50 meters.
He
looks big in this movie.
At some point. But yeah, so during our setup chapter, we also get introduced to Audrey, who we kind of mentioned is not the strongest suit in this movie, but we see that she's clearly kind of working under this sleazeball newscaster boss. And I like the little stuff that they add about this guy. Obviously, he makes a bunch of comments that, again, that will probably land in our "What Didn't Age So Well." But I liked him scooching himself up in the chair while being on air. He like sat down. They're like, "Oh, 3, 2, 1." He's like, he just stood up the whole time while they're just a small little thing in the background that you could pick up on, which I really liked. But
3, 2. Hello, New York. Today at 5, we'll ask Fat Pat, when will this rain end?
This scene also clearly set up that there's a past between Audrey and Nick, because we go from the scenes with Nick and it cuts immediately to Audrey. And you're like, okay, it's just another side character, whatever, we're learning backstory. And then when it cuts right back to Nick, he's talking about how there was the one that got away and stuff like that. And you're like, okay, I can see from a Godzilla away where this is going.
With the awkward, creepy Dr. Chapman saying, oh, I think you're the right guy for the job.
Wasn't it weird he still has pictures of her? Why don't you come over to my...
Well, we get to that later, but yeah, that's very weird. But yeah, the newscaster guy being like, well, why don't you come on over and we could talk about it. It's like, yeah,
well, remember, he was gonna marry her, man. It's hard to let that go sometimes.
Yeah, right. And then we get this little dinner, the diner scene, really, where we're then introduced to Hank, and she just happens to conveniently see Nick is on TV, because this is starting to become a story now, the whole footprints in Panama, the missing boat, all this stuff. So that's really what set the tone for this movie, or for the story at least. Fast forward now to chapter 2. This is kind of the arrival in New York, which we were told it's New York, not by it saying New York, New York, by giving us the oh so stereotypical 90s cliche of green computer writing saying the city that never sleeps. Just
terrible.
Gotta love the 90s, man. That was the title card for just about everything. All you can hear is like,
yeah, that phony computer sound. Like,
why didn't they show that originally? Because they showed that in the second time you see New York, but when they introduce Audrey, Cayman, and everybody, they're in New York when she's late for work and stuff. Why didn't they put that print there, like the city that never sleeps?
Couldn't tell you. Unanswerable question right there.
Why put it all?
Yeah, it was a little unnecessary. But we see Godzilla coming to the city because Joe, that poor old bastard fisherman, oh, who knows, could be my lucky day. Just getting chastised by all the other real fishermen. And here's this schmuck coming down to the pier in New York to go fishing. And
in the rain.
In the rain.
Oh, wait, never mind. Everything happens in the rain.
The whole thing is in the rain. What is this, a goddamn David Fincher movie? Like, I don't understand the rain part of this. This movie doesn't need rain. There's no significance to it at all.
I think it's because of his radiation.
That's what I read. Yeah. It messes with weather patterns.
Devlin in Panama. He said they did that as homage to the original, but then people that are fans say that it was very little rain in the original and that they must have done it to like make the effects easier to cover up or something, and then the director defended that saying that's not true. So if it wasn't in the original, that's not the true story. I have no idea why it had to rain every scene
everywhere. You start seeing like different shades of rain on some scenes. You're like, oh, this is a shower rain, that is a different rain. It's like they overdo it. I think Panama. I think
it's true. Panama City. There was no good weather in this whole.
Yeah. No, the Panama scene was the only time there was sunlight in the movie. I went back. I'm like, dude, this 95% rain.
A story I read was the actors were given wetsuits to wear under their costumes. Did you read this? This is funny.
Go on. I like this one.
Matthew Broderick. It's like, That thing was so hard to get in and out because you're trying to zip it up the back, up and down. He's like, I hated that thing. And he was talking to Frank Azzara one day and he looks at him and he's like, oh, your wetsuit zips in the front? That'd be a lot easier. And he's like, they all do. Turns out Broderick was wearing the wetsuit through the whole movie.
Idiot. But yes, I was actually going to bring that up because I love that. I love that. Joe the fisherman must have the cast of a lifetime because he launches this thing out a mile into the river and he's got a big bite. This thing is reeling in and it's starting to tug and pull at him. But we see this giant thing coming towards him. The water's moving. And I don't know how the physics of it work because Godzilla is coming towards him, but the line's getting tighter.
Oh!
I feel like it would be Godzilla floating away, which would be making it tighter. But either way, Joe is a strong old bastard because he was holding on against Godzilla for a while until
he runs very fast. Yeah.
It pops on out. And I do like that. Clearly something is really wrong here. Like, this is like a typhoon wave and everybody on the docks is still just like, ha, 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 look at that. You got a big one, Joe. I'm like, no, run. This is wrong. This is not okay. Joe is... did Joe make it? Do you think Joe made it? Because he was running for dear life off that pier and it looked like he was in the clear.
I think he
made it. Is Joe dead?
He didn't make it.
It's like the most underwhelming reveal ever. Come on.
Yeah, so we get that. We kind of see where it's going from here. And Godzilla is now in New York stomping around. We don't get the full Godzilla shot. We get, you know, the foot. We get this stuff like that. A couple things that I noticed when the stomping was happening. A, the truck driver was just listening to headphones and didn't notice or hear or see that the car was bouncing and shaking and everyone was moving around. Just didn't notice a thing there. Just thought that was all normal. Maybe a subway was going by or something. I don't know what was going on in his mind, but that was a moment that stuck out. And also the fact that Godzilla was like walking very far away and everything bounced.
But they didn't quite all get it right. Like if you watch the actors and the cars and they didn't quite all get it in sync.
Well, how about the fact that when they're
and the actor jumps up a little bit and you're like, you were like a couple seconds late, bro, and you just didn't get it right.
Well, how about the fact that when people are running from him, now nothing is moving. Like, they're not bouncing when he's that close to him. It's just in those, like, shots where they had the practical effects set up to bounce the cars. For.
The kind of, like, what is that moment? I get it.
That's what gives you city swag.
Yeah. But this carries all the way through city. You know, the panic is starting, and the panic is now brought to the little diner scene where Audrey and... Oh, what is this?
Animal.
Animal, yeah. Animal.
Victor
see something's going on, and then Victor decides to run out to go see what's going on, and we get the most typical Italian, oh my Jesus, Mary and Joseph. Like, you just might as well just have him go, oh mamma mia, oh my god, what am I gonna do? You couldn't write him anything more stereotypical for this. And then we get hit with the lines that, man, if you weren't sure that this movie was made in the 90s, these lines will do it for you. Where his wife,
yep, Lucy,
yells at him to get back here, you retard.
Oh, yeah.
That's like, not flying in the theaters nowadays. And as you can see by my tagline, I don't think that's as offensive today, because Italian people don't really get offended unless you're in the mob, I guess. But, you know, you crazy wop. Like, another slur. You're two for two right there. Not really a great wife. I'm glad that she had a very minimal role in this one, because I wasn't really buying that. If you want to call it chemistry, you call it chemistry. There's playful banter, and then there's just being a fucking...
She wasn't a good act. Who did she know to get that role? She knew somebody.
Somehow. But we're also introduced to the army. You know, the army setup is somehow already up and running in the city.
Communicating. Yeah.
They're already ready to go. There was video that aired a half an hour ago that's already on air, and they already have stations set up. So I guess we can just go and believe that maybe the army beforehand. You hit
a pet peeve, like, it's crazy. The logistics it takes to set stuff up. They're set up like nobody's business. Like, they had been there a month.
This is New York.
There's a spot where these guys go through a checkpoint, and it's got all the signage and the gates, and it's all set up. It's like, there's installations that don't have a gate that good. Like, but you set this up today to stop traffic. Like,
well, my favorite thing is too, is why is a lowly E5 Sergeant O'Neill running the show? Like he's Colonel Hicks's like right hand man, an E, like just a, not a first sergeant, not a sergeant major.
Yeah. And I don't
sergeant.
And I don't blame like this movie for it.
Yelling at the mayor.
Every movie that has like a military presence going on, for me, has the same problem. Somebody said, okay, there's a bunch of military guys here and they're doing a military stuff. Okay, what are they supposed to do? I don't know, but have them do military stuff. And every guy in the scene that's in the military is like a really badly programmed NPC from a video game. They might as well be like walking up against walls, because this guy's like with weapons, like going in weird directions. Like, am I fighting somebody? Am
no
I protecting something?
Dude, no,
am I searching? No. Is it a perimeter? What are we doing? Nothing. Just like look stupid and walk around in circles and face different directions and carry all different kinds
and
of
salute.
That means
don't forget to salute
together and all have really bad haircuts and just look like you're programmed to do nothing because we don't know what we're supposed to do here. But that happens in lots of movies. So they
I just love the generic army talk. Echo one, sir, locked on, sir. We're ready to go, sir. Fire at will, sir. It's like
we lost Echo two. We lost Echo three. Where's like, Echo four?
Somebody just went to Google. Well, maybe not back then. Back then they probably went to AskJeeves.com and we're just like, Google search, what do army people say? And they're like, oh, we got a list. Yeah, just run them all. It's fine. But we're starting.
What should they be doing? What should the guys in the background be doing?
There was no hold. No.
Just no. Army.
Army stuff.
Army.
I mean, just quickly back to like the boat scene. The military's there. Okay. There's one of every different military vehicle they could find, all parked in a line like they're at the 7-Eleven. There's people walking all around the scene. So the army's not keeping people out, but yet there's just random guys like with weapons, their long guns, like milling around the crowd. And then there's helicopters that are like buzzing it and like attacking it. Like, well, what are we attacking? Like, why are we buzzing? Is this Black Hawk down? Like, and then you say to yourself, well, what's the operation here? They're just doing military stuff.
However, you gotta give them a little bit of credit.
Just Army.
Just a little bit. The Navy didn't look that bad in the subs. This isn't
Hunt for Red October. We got submarines in the Hudson River. That's about 50
Godzilla feet. Did lure two torpedoes at the other torpedo.
Embrace for
the other submarine.
But yeah, so we're back to
this. They were hitting buttons smart. It looked more believable than what the soldiers are doing.
That's true.
Stand by three. Fire. Torpedo three. Pit and left the two. In 8 seconds,
the city is starting to get evacuated at this point, and
except for the pub,
except for the pharmacy, except for the guy selling hot dogs on the streets. But yeah, this is we start to see the remnants of Godzilla, right? We get that shot of the big, large building with the hole in the middle, which I don't know if that's physically possible. I don't know if you remember that scene, but the bottom floors were still intact, and then there was a big hole in the middle, and the top was still intact. Building was still up. So did he jump through that or something?
That's what I think. I think he just jumped right through it.
Just like a cannonball. It was just like a lot of playground.
It makes a lot of sense. It's like the MetLife building was made out of cardboard.
And they did, which worked a little bit. They did the suspenseful, like you didn't get to see him above his legs for a good beginning of the movie. Like they were trying to build like some suspense there.
Well, my favorite part, like building suspense, the three boats that get dragged down into the water at the beginning of the show, that was good. One of my favorite scenes, right? It's crazy how the boats were sailing really close to each other, like pirate boats, but still, like that was great. That was a good intro, I think. I mean, you know, but
yeah, Godzilla kind of wreaked havoc and then he went into hiding. You know, they know that he hasn't left the island and he's hiding, which I don't know how they know that he hasn't left the island because they don't really seem to track him very well throughout this movie, but they're sure he's somewhere hiding. This giant monster that has destroyed buildings is hiding.
Yeah, speaking of that, they said they couldn't see him on heat signatures in some scene in the movie. They couldn't see his heat. So how did they how do you track someone like that?
They had a hard time tracking this fucking thing.
Yeah.
Like it was ridiculous. Like best way to track him was using a taxi. What is it? The taxi radio state? Oh, dude.
Yeah, the car. Yeah. No. But we're also introduced before we get into the next chapter. We're kind of seeing more about the whole French subplot and Felipe. This is where he bugs the mayor. You know, they're sitting in a UPS truck and doing all this like espionage. How is he just infiltrating Everything. I guess another question we can't answer, but
you talked earlier about stereotypes. Like, you couldn't have written a scene, the coffee scene, all of it. More.
You said this was French roast.
Yeah, there's no croissants. He's holding the soggy donut. Like,
I was saying that as I was watching it. I was like,
not only do we blame all of this nuclear problems on the French, now we're going to make fun of them.
It's just, it felt very, like with everything in this movie, right? You know, the Italian guy, they gave him the generic Italian lines. The Japanese sailors in the beginning, they're like, oh, they got their Japanese, so they have to watch sumo. Gojira. They have to do it. And then the French, they're like, well, they have to just be smoking. And, oh, oui, non ça, oui, me croissant. And it's like, you can write characters that aren't just...
I thought you said this was French roast.
It's just so...
French roast, bleh.
This is America, sir. It's like, this is really fucking crazy. But yeah, so that kind of leads us to chapter 3, where it is simply labeled by me as Godzilla 1, Army 0. The... military is trying to pursue Godzilla at this point and figure out what they're doing. And their first attempt is to just, I guess, at Nick's suggestion, pile a bunch of fish in the street and open up sewer drains. Because I guess when the higher ups in the military are taking advice from the worm guy, this is what you're left with. It's just, sure. Yeah. But this is where we get that first, like, money shot of Godzilla. This is where you first see, you know, the beast in all his glory. Comes up from the sewers. He's looking down at Nick, which is weird because now he's not aggressive. There's like a connection between him and Nick that you can kind of pick up on those, like, subtle, we're not ripping off Jurassic Park, but we're absolutely ripping off Jurassic Park theme song starts playing. It's a little interesting. What did you think about that whole first shot of the Godzilla in this movie? Are you like, that's a good shot? Did he look not how you wanted or expected?
I was like, what the hell is that? That's not my Godzilla. First reaction was like, what the hell is that?
It's not Godzilla.
Yeah, exactly. It was again, not having watched all the Godzilla movies, not being a fan, in my mind that was a little bit of, that's not what I expected.
Exactly.
It's a bigger version of the lizard from Spider-Man.
Yeah.
He just needs a lab coat.
Well, like, to see him in all his might power, he can't just be crouched. Like, you gotta be,
erected,
hot. Yeah, and like,
because Jimmy, historically, it's more dinosaur, at least looking, if not truly based, right?
Right. Yeah.
I forget. I think like Godzilla means like a combination of like gorilla and whale, I think, or something like that, right? But
look at the action figure in front of Jimmy. Look at the shoulders on that guy.
Yeah, he's got the Brock Lesnar traps.
Exactly.
So it was supposed to be, the original design was like a gorilla whale kind of creature, and they kind of scrapped it and went more towards like a dinosaur, like a combination of a T-Rex and a Stegosaurus.
Right.
Because back then in the 40s, back then too, when they were doing, you know, paleontologists had a lot of dinosaurs upright, and then they started having them hunched forward and stuff throughout the skeletal structure. So you have a lot, you know, Godzilla stands upright, and obviously it's a guy in a suit too.
But like you said, Emmerich that was conscious. He went into this to change up the monster. So it's like the expected, right?
Exactly. And I have some interesting notes about that. So he didn't want that look. He didn't like the actual design of Godzilla. He thought, you know, he wanted something fast. And that's what he went to Patrick Tatopoulos, shocker. They went real far with Nick Tatopoulos because they just named him after the
production designer.
Exactly. So Patrick Tatopoulos, told Patrick Tatopoulos he wants it fast. He's like, whatever you do, just make them fast. And Patrick Tatopoulos went with a whole bunch of sketches and designs and then came up with this one. And then Patrick Tatopoulos kind of put his own little spin on it too, with giving Godzilla a chin. And the reason he gave Godzilla a chin was that when Patrick Tatopoulos was a kid, he was afraid of Shere Khan from The Jungle Book, who had this big, powerful chin. You know, he was feared. He gave a little homage to Shere Khan from The Jungle Book.
Wow. Yeah, it was an interesting character design, I thought. I was more expecting the brute style versus more lizard oriented.
I don't think we get a good shot at all in the whole movie.
Yeah, that, I mean that's
you the get, you it's only dark get and raining.
Crotch, right? You only get crotch from the bottom up, and then claws, and then just jaw and shirt gone.
Yeah, he had a big ass head.
Yeah, you don't get a whole like where is the monster? Like, I thought he would climb up a building or something. No,
you would think. Really... You know, you put him in New York City.
Well, he kind of best... does. He kind of does. After he like beats the helicopters, he kind of jumps up on top of that building and lets out that like almost like iconic shot where he roars and the lightning flashes.
When he gets trapped in the bridge, it's like the best full body shot. That you're like, oh,
I'm about to say that's the only time you see him.
This is the monster. You're like, ah, cool. And then you start crying for no reason because you feel bad.
Well, that's the problem I think I have with this movie. I mean, there are a lot of problems, but the problem with this movie, I think for me, is that Roland Emmerich doesn't know as far as, I mean, he doesn't know the character. Like I said, he doesn't like the character. He did this movie because they gave him free rein of whatever he wanted to do.
So he wasn't really interested in the lineage.
No, he wasn't really invested. Yeah. So my thing is this, is that he can't decide whether Godzilla in this movie is benevolent or malevolent.
He can't even decide if it's a he or a she.
Let's say sexual.
What fun is that?
Yeah, right. And that's my thing. I don't think like when he's when he makes his initial contact with New York, and which I love. I think it's one of the best setups ever. But he's strictly just migrating. He's just a bit, you know, he's just moving through. He's not intentionally destroying the city. Right. You know, he's just moving through the city.
Right.
Which, and it's like Nick says too, he's not an enemy trying to evade you. He's just an animal. And that's what he is. You made him into an animal.
Yeah. And I'm sure we'll talk about that more, but that's pretty much one of the core differences in this movie is it's an animal instincts, giant. So it's causing all this havoc, but that's different than the original like premise of Godzilla, which is this unnatural force, you know, doesn't fear anything, and it's out to just go after people. It's two very different, I don't know if the technical term is monsters, but two very different entities. One that's like just a giant animal that's doing what it needs to survive, versus the original Godzilla, I think, is like this crazy, unkillable, afraid of nothing force that's out intentionally going after people.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but this leads to the blatant ripoff of the Jaws line. We need bigger guns. Fire at will. And then they miss every single shot and destroy all the buildings themselves. Not how do you miss that? I don't even shoot guns. And I guarantee you, I could hit Godzilla. There's no chance you miss Godzilla.
Yeah, this thing's like, not going to be a military recruiting film.
Well, I feel like
going to be all we can be here.
I feel like this more people than Godzilla.
I feel like the skin sample that Nick picks up wasn't from the army actually hitting him, but Godzilla whacking his head into the building and scraping a piece of flesh off.
That or when he like threw up on Nick before he came out of the sewer or sneezed or whatever that was.
Oh, right. Because he like,
but that's the thing.
He had the hot breath. He didn't have the atomic breath that he should have had, but he had the hot breath or something.
And that was also in the dossier. He has to have atomic breath. And then they went a different route
with fire.
With
a 1 second clip of him breathing fire.
Well, I power, think he caused it's called, fire. But
yeah, it's called like power breath.
Fire because he blew on something, but he didn't breathe fire.
Right? I think his breath is like almost like it ignites.
Axe body spray.
Yeah.
But yeah, absolute military failure. This is just a debacle unlike
more than
others. They fudge this thing up more times than you can count, but they're driving behind him down the streets, they're shooting, and they're still missing him. And then this is where we get those atomic or power breath. But then we bring in the choppers. You got three choppers. Target's locked on, sir. Target's locked on. Engage, shooting, go, go, go. And they fire at him, and he just kind of like slowly dodges it, and it blows up the Chrysler building, which I don't know how they knew it was the Chrysler building, because they don't have live video footage. All he says was, it's not a direct hit. And then the mayor's like, that's the goddamn Chrysler building. Whoa, 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 whoa. It's like, How do you know? You wouldn't know that. Didn't know what he hit or didn't hit.
Emmerich in his films likes to blow up like national monuments and well-known national landmarks and stuff. He likes to blow up well-known things.
Mm. But yeah. But again, we got hit with the generic, you know, Echo 4, engage, blah, 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 blah.
So, but even when they panned back on those scenes, you say like this, the helicopters that came in close, again, to the military thing. There's scenes where there's helicopters that the person who designed, did this animation or graphics or special effects, the only thing they'd ever seen was a World War II bomber group, because there's helicopters and there's hundreds of them flying in perfect bombing formation.
And this close to each other.
And their flight dynamics, like even when the helicopters are now in the city and they're going down these streets, the flight dynamics, these are X-Fighters from Star Wars. They're like...
dipping and diving.
A helicopter doesn't do that.
No, that is so true.
Where were the jets? Just bring in the jets.
No.
But it kind of sort of ends with them finding a hole and just them assuming that Godzilla went in there. And they just fire blindly into this building, thinking that it's there. It's not like knowing what is in there, just firing. And well, the city's I think we got him.
Shoot the pharmacy or the pub, yeah. And you are good.
Well, it reminds me of that scene from Predator where they just start shooting at the trees. Yeah. Remember where they just waste all their ammo just shooting at the tree? Yeah.
They're like, oh, I think we got him. And guess what? You didn't got him, because Godzilla somehow got out of your sight, snuck behind you, and is attacking you from behind. It left us with one helicopter flying around. I didn't understand why the helicopter didn't just go up. Because, I mean, Godzilla just can't fly. So you can fly up and away. You don't have to just, like, have a chase scene throughout the buildings, but sure. This brings us to the next little stage of failure, where it's Nick's kind of gullibility, where he goes into said pharmacy store to pick up pregnancy tests, because I don't know why he was like, oh, I want to test if it's pregnant, but also the fact that pregnancy tests detect HCG, which is human chorionic whatever. Keyword human. This ain't working for Godzilla. So anything you test or say is not accurate. Even he says it. He says these are for humans, but it shows that it's pregnant. Like, so you preface it by telling me this is not accurate, but we are going to base it off of your evidence.
It's true. What made him look at the blood and go, I don't want to know what it is. I want to know if it's pregnant.
I think because it was migrating, and I think he kind of put that together. He was just like, oh, well, a lot of animals travel great distances to migrate. And I think that's what he was,
right?
That was his theory.
If an animal, like it was down in the Pacific in these big rainforests with lots of wilderness, and it says, I need to nest. I know where I'm going to go. I'm going to go find the most populated city in North America, and that's where I'm going to nest. Seems very animal-like to me.
It's a cool stadium there that I can nest at.
Well, we wouldn't have a movie, Kevin.
I love the Knicks. I got to go.
I think to Nick's point, though, it's like getting a pregnancy test is like two on the nose. Like, he could have shaken two test tubes, mix them around, and pour them in a flask and be like, it's pregnant. And we'd be like, I would buy that. Shit. Yeah. We'd be like, no way. No, this motherfucker went to CVS. All right,
or find some compound, like, and say, oh, this secretion is from egg laying.
Say stuff that I don't know about, but what I know about is I know that pregnancy tests are for humans.
There's two lines.
But this is where we do, I think Diaz or somebody had mentioned it earlier, but we get insight into Nick's little, you know, secret tent or whatever, but him and Audrey have been split up for 8 years. She dipped on him, declining his proposal, and he still just keeps pictures around of them because he is an absolute sucker. This dude is a beta through and through. And he brings her in, and she immediately steals his top secret federal evidence and leaks it to the news. So she's 1,000% going to prison. Like, there's no ifs, ands, or buts about this. I don't care.
Hey, she's trying to make a career.
Yeah, sure.
No, she's not.
Yeah, good job with that. Because with her tagline of,
in the big city, if she can't make it there, if she can make it there, she can make it anywhere.
If her lead in,
dinner with Chapman, she didn't.
Yeah. If her lead in to any of her other news, you know, articles are as good as all the king's horses and all the king's men may not be able to put the Big Apple back again, if they're all just as good as that, I can't believe she's not on TV. Because Jesus, she's just the worst. I hate her. A middle schooler news show could have had better taglines than her.
Well, but yeah, the whole love story is trash.
It's just forced.
It would have been better if he was attracted to her, like, wow, this girl's beautiful. Like, he sell her all the information as an idiot because he's so dumbfounded by her beauty. But
I would buy that if she was like that beautiful actual news reporter just using her beauty to get to the evidence. I'd get that. But when you key in the backstory of they used to date 8 years ago, he proposed, she just left without saying anything, and you see that person again, you're not like, oh, hey, let's go catch up. Let's go. Let me make you some tea. Like, it's been not happening.
People change. Not everybody changes. You know what? You're right. Let's catch some tea. Oh my God. It's beautiful. It's fucking master. It's a masterpiece.
So
I didn't realize, as far as
these movies go, like, did this one have obviously a heavier character portion or script? I know that Godzilla's only shown in this movie 11 minutes in total. Is that like, are there usually a lot of human storylines going on in these movies, or does this one differ in that way too?
No, for the most part there is. I mean, there's definitely, like, you know, the Monsterverse, for instance, which is our new series of Godzilla films and Kong films and stuff. There's definitely a lot more human element, but I think the way to make like a great Godzilla film, I think obviously check, you know, if you haven't seen it, the original, and then the one that just came out this winter, Godzilla Minus One. I think if you can tie the character into the monster, it works. And I think that's, as far as the Monsterverse is going, the characters aren't really, I feel like, tied it. They're not as interesting. You know, if you can somehow have them be like a yin and yang and kind of, you know, or mesh them together, it makes for a way better story, way more powerful story. And there is a lot more human element, but it's gotta be done right. And I feel like we've kind of failed on that front.
Well, I think this movie, like the human elements just fail. Like, there's not a solid character that you want to watch and know what's happening to them. So it's hard. Like, you don't even watch the military trying to figure it out, because they just can't. You don't want to watch the love story because it's a mess. You don't want to watch French guy because, like, you don't even know what he's doing. It's just so hard to balance it out throughout the whole movie. Plus, the script is so, like, spoon-fed. Like, there's so many.
As I said earlier, I realized that they, during the process of making this movie, you know, maybe early on, but how they scrapped the screenplay and the new team rewrote the screenplay, to me, it seemed like that's what happened. And we got a quick draft version of a script, and it didn't get flushed out because they started from scratch over. But
well, a problem also was they kept, like, during the marketing campaign, they kept a really tight lid on it. So, like, obviously you'd only get like the iconic eye or a foot, you know, but they didn't want to reveal him. And I think a big problem was because they didn't want to reveal him until the movie debuted, they didn't test screen it at all. So they weren't able to go back to the drawing board. They just kind of showed it.
And they couldn't do the Sonic the Hedgehog.
Right. Oh yeah. Yeah. I remember those.
They would have Sonic the Hedgehog.
Yeah. They would have redone this whole thing, I'd say. But yeah, well,
I don't think Emery cared that much. He's just like, fuck it. No. I don't care.
This was a big check.
He wanted the check.
Yeah. So during the, you know, of all the evidence they stole, one of them was that original scene that we saw, the Gajira with the, you know, head French guy kind of leading an interview with the guy that only speaks Japanese. But
I'm not sure, why did the flame bring him back to consciousness? Because, like, I didn't know if I was missing some underlying meaning. Nope. There.
I had to look that up. Apparently it was supposed to clear his senses and him focusing on the flame.
Who was filming this? Because in that original scene, it's like, oh, this makes sense. This is for us. This is a movie scene. But then the clips they use are the scenes they showed us. And it was just the French guy and that Japanese guy in there. There was no camera crew in there filming this. So
why would the French guy give up that footage too? Like, why would he lose that footage?
Who knows?
Hold it in a top secret and put it in the top.
Well, when she comes in with it, she's like, the French government just released this.
Yeah. But so this airs, and they immediately obviously fire Nick and get him out of the military operations because supposedly he leaked this information. He went to the reporters, which, I mean, who's really to blame in this situation? The military that just blew up half of New York because they missed the creature, or the guy that somebody stole something out of a tent?
Wouldn't he have gotten arrested? Wouldn't he have got locked up right there?
Probably.
Jimmy, wouldn't he have been in jail?
I would assume so. Like, losing top secret federal information.
Go home.
I think
now.
You're gone.
Go tell people everything else now. The rest of the story.
You're go to the gone. Airport because he's going to the Newark airport because it's open still because they're still flying commercial. Go catch JetBlue out of Newark airport. It's on sale right now. It costs $40 to fly out, but you might get eaten by a lizard.
There was still a taxi driver that picked them up easy.
Yep. The taxi driver. So yeah, we're going to kind of buzz through a little bit here, but essentially Nick is the taxi driver is the French guy. He brings him into the fold of the whole French operation. And then we cut to the whole Audrey and Victor crying scene, which is probably the worst acting I've seen so far in any of the movies that we've watched for this, this podcast, because I just didn't buy a second of that. But Godzilla wins again. Both parties are now kind of really buying stock into the whole Nest proponent of this story, and they're trying to go find him out while the military is doing yet another fish pile. So we have the French plus Nick heading towards the Nest, and then we have Audrey and Animal following them and trying to track them while the military is out playing with fish again in the middle of Central Park. It worked out so well the last time. What could possibly go wrong? Well, I can tell you, we could triple the helicopters in the streets. We could triple the missiles, and we could still miss all of this. Godzilla evades all of this and jumps headfirst into the Hudson, which we already mentioned that, I mean, nothing in this next scene, nothing of this is possible. There's no chance there's submarines in the Hudson. There's no chance Godzilla is swimming around in the Hudson. There's no chance that they're locking on these missiles and they're just tailing Godzilla and they smash into the subs.
I think the Hunt for Red October, I think, proved that. I think they might have been in the Hudson, weren't they?
Listen, you got to understand, as the New York person here, look up at Google the Hudson River. You don't know what's in that river. There's bodies. That's like Jason Voorhees type water. You don't know what is in that lake, man.
There's Godzillas.
Yeah, like it's just there's something in the water, man. There's something in the water.
But finally, after destroying a couple subs, Godzilla is hit and he's now floating around and dead. Or is he? Who knows? The next chapter of this movie brings us to the Nest. And these next parts really just kind of fly by because essentially the Nest is about as much of a ripoff of Jurassic Park and the Velociraptors as you can get. They come to find out that Godzilla has laid all of the eggs inside Madison Square Garden. Not one, not two, not three, not 20, but hundreds, which the whole building is destroyed, but all the power works. All the lights show up so we can have that big dramatic showing of the eggs because, yeah, sure. But it's about, like I said, about 30 minutes or so of just Jurassic Park ripoffs. All the stereotypes of locking a door with a broomstick, the eggs start to hatch. And then we kind of end this scene with a live in-person interview from Madison Square Garden being simulcast live to all networks once they show that the creatures are kind of walking around. And they bring Nick on screen to confirm that he was right. The army is wrong. Everybody's stupid. He's smart. And he's still wearing the army jacket. Is that considered stolen valor? He should be arrested for that, right? That's not right, Nick. You know better than that. And they pretty much they do like a very formal interview while just being chased. So not only do they do the interview, they found the equipment, they set this up, they got it live cast, all while being chased by these baby Godzillas. They had plenty of times on their hand, I guess. Not just going on air and be like, bomb this place immediately. Kill everything, like including me. I don't care. Just don't let these things get out. Thankfully, they lock all the babies in the building and Nick stops them with basketballs and gumballs because he's got to throw some cheeky little comedy in there. And
go Knicks! Go Knicks! Yeah.
But the problem is that they locked the doors to keep them in there. But the way they got into the garden was through the giant hole in the middle of the floor that they came up in through.
Yep.
None of the little dinosaurs realizes this big gaping hole in the middle that they can just go down and out through.
Yeah. So we have about 6 minutes for them to get out of there before this place gets blasted, because the military finally saw the footage and they're like, all right, send in the strike unit. There's no way they get out of this building and aren't harmed by this mass bombing. No chance, because this thing blows up, everything in there dies, and they're mere feet away, not a scratch on them.
Save your Mavericks. Two away.
I don't know. I don't buy that. But out of nowhere, Godzilla emerges. He was not dead. The submarines did not kill him. He was just, I don't know what he was doing, floating around in the river a little bit, rejuvenating. But this kind of brings us to our final chapter, which is the final fight. And this, again, there's a lot in this, but there's really not a lot that's happening in this. He's being, you know, they put a knife in the ignition. They start a taxi. There's a whole car chase. Godzilla's eating the car, but it still works. And they lure him over to, is it the Brooklyn? Not the Brooklyn Bridge. Forget the bridge. Was it That's the Brooklyn it. Bridge?
Yeah.
They bring him over to the suspension bridge so he can kind of get trapped in all the wires and absolutely lit up by the military. I'm surprised they actually hit him this time, but they trap him.
What's the name of that tunnel? Diaz, do you recognize the tunnel?
Yeah, that's the Lincoln Tunnel. The Lincoln Tunnel.
Okay, so is the Brooklyn Bridge the closest to the Lincoln Tunnel?
No. Oh, well, it's
according to the movie, it is.
It's close to it. It's not the closest, but it is close. It's close enough. Nice.
It was the nearest suspension bridge.
I don't think that's true either, though. I think they're both suspensions. But either way, They trap him there. They light him up with the missiles, and he falls down, eyes close, and then we get hit with one of the worst sampling of Led Zeppelin of all time with Puff Daddy, you know, working over the song of Kashmir with Jimmy Page. That's kind of it, except we get hit with a stinger before the credits roll that one of the eggs has not yet hatched. So interesting little stinger scene, but that is kind of the chapters of Godzilla 98. So like we mentioned, box office wise, you know, it had decent numbers. Still, I'm not sure if you have the reviews ready to go, but the box office, like we mentioned, it made about $380 million. The budget was 130 to 150. And the marketing budget was 80 million. So when it's all added up, you know, it made probably 150 million when it's all said and done. But it wasn't viewed as a successful box office hit. That was a pretty disappointing figure. So I'm curious if the reviews kind of line up. I know Jimmy has mentioned that in the Godzilla fandom, this is not a very well-renowned movie, but I'm curious what the kind of general consensus of this thing was.
Yeah. Are you sure you're curious?
I'm very curious. I'm so curious. I couldn't be more curious.
It's pretty much out there, bro. So this tomato. It's tomato meter. 20%.
Yeah.
And that's the critics.
That hurts Jimmy right there. That hurt Jimmy. That hurt him.
Yeah. I was ready for it. 20%. Yeah. And then audience score, the way better. 28%.
Oh man,
a little trash can next to it. It's rough. It's rough, but like it sold a lot of money. Like it made a lot of money because it was a duh movie that everybody got to watch. There's sometimes movies that you're like, oh, have you watched it yet? No, it sucks. Oh, but I still got to watch it.
Yeah,
you know, it was a big deal. It was the first Godzilla American. Like it's everybody saw it, and yeah, it's just terrible. And they saw Audrey again. Jesus Christ. But I have a couple of reviews, though. So we got a good review here saying, this is an Americanized version of Godzilla. It's praised for its fast-paced action, featuring one of the best Japanese characters. The film's budget, production values, and blockbuster approach thrilling, adrenaline-fueled monster flick experience. Unlike other iterations, Godzilla appears early on, and the action sequences are a major highlight. While some find the design less superior compared to the newer versions, it's still intense. The human characters are engaging now, and performances are enjoyed now. Set in New York, the film allows for larger scale destruction, special effects are impressive, and the editing is sharp. Despite potential reasons for dislike, the reviewer personally found it highly enjoyable and engaging, especially in the actions overall, and it's seen one of the best American action films. Wow. Okay. I can't believe I picked this, and I'm still like amazed by it. But I got a bad one, too.
Oh, I can't wait for this one.
Bring it on.
Let's see. I definitely have negative opinion about it. I've seen enough of Toho's Godzilla movies to know how little Emmerich's film had in common with them. And I've heard enough over the years that it's clear that Emmerich was never a fan and didn't care about the films to begin with. That said, I also only ever saw the film when I was really young and didn't have the attention span to really follow it. My distaste for the movie is probably being more because it sounds like Emmerich created as a middle finger to the Godzilla fandom than anything I remember about the film's quality itself. Obviously, knowing about the Jan the Bond film we could have had instead doesn't help either. I do think the design was cool, though. In a movie that had more in common with the Japanese Godzilla, it would have been fantastic.
Yeah, I think that sounds pretty on par for what we were anticipating. It's just not amazing.
I mean, the middle finger to the fandom, like, that's true. Like, I feel like you're expecting something else, and this guy just said, I don't care. I'm doing whatever I want. I don't care about anybody else. This is going to do good no matter what. So here it is.
Yeah, Doing. That's definitely where it is. So let's jump into our segments a little bit where we're going to break this thing down a little bit. Let's start it up with our stack it up. So Diaz, what are we stacking this thing up a little bit with?
Well, it's a kaiju. So it's a Japanese monster. That's what kaiju means, right, Jimmy?
Yep.
Basically, a Japanese monster.
Giant monster, yeah.
There's two things when I think of giant monsters. And the way that this was animated, he looks like a big-ass Power Ranger villain. He also looks like a cheap version of any monster from Pacific Rim. So my stack up question is twofold. Can the Power Rangers come together in New York City with their Zords to beat this Godzilla? Or is this Godzilla who outsmarted our military? Can this Godzilla outsmart 5 teenage kids with attitude?
That's a great one.
He's pretty frail. I mean, he got taken out by a couple of F-18s, so I think the Dragon Zord or the Megazord could make quick of Godzilla 98.
I'd have to go with the Zord as well, honestly. I know that it's just the Power Rangers that are functioning it, but the capabilities of the Zord are
amazing.
I think far beyond what the military showed. You know, like they could take a sword that's the size of him. And
just slice
stab them through. You know, they can, it can take power. It can withstand power. It has a lot of different capabilities. It's very fast, but I think the Zord takes down this Godzilla. I don't know if it takes down every Godzilla, but I think this one.
Well, this Godzilla is pretty elusive too. He's pretty elusive. I mean, he could go underground, you know, I mean,
he can could evade. Hide from him.
Yeah.
Get a water. I've never seen a sword in the water.
It's a good point. Oh, the only Zord in the water would be the Dragon Zord. Yeah. That's the only one though. Yeah, exactly. Go Tommy. Rest in peace.
Yeah, but this Godzilla gets taken out, but not even they don't even have to come together. The red sword just takes it.
The pterodactyl will just fly.
Yeah, just one of them. It don't matter. Yeah.
Okay, so then if the Zords take him out, then it has no chance against the Pacific Rim's monsters.
The Jaegers.
No, the Jaegers, because the Jaegers would destroy the Power Rangers.
What do you think, Kev?
I don't know a lot about this Zord you speak of, but the fact that this Godzilla was afraid of the taxi headlights, the high beams, scared it. Whoever you stack it up against, I'm not taking him.
I got you, Kev, because you're the old guy. Can Voltron beat this Godzilla?
I think everybody beats this Godzilla.
Yeah.
I mean, only because, again, they wrote it and did it in such a state that he's just a big animal. Like the destruction that he does is because of his size. I mean, if you had a giant raccoon in your house and you were chasing it around and it's knocking down all your furniture and breaking everything, it's the size, right? He wasn't this monstrous force that was there to do evil. He's just this big animal trying to get out of your way, and he happens to be so big, he's knocking over all your buildings.
It's more clumsy than dangerous.
The babies show that they're pack hunters too. So if they all fully grew, if they were all fully grown,
that a pack mentality might be very
then
different.
There's a problem. Right. Then there's a problem. So if it's an actual, if it actually grew to out, you know, to replace man as the dominant species,
we'll be done.
There'd be an alpha. There would be an alpha too. Like,
right. But like, I mean, they showed as babies that they coordinated and they were pack hunters. So this type of Godzilla seems to be.
But as long as you have high beams, you are
just like raptors.
Oh, okay. So we think the technological aspect of Power Rangers, such a weird sentence to say, the Power Rangers and the Jaegers from Pacific Rim could kill this Godzilla.
Pacific Rim, those were man-made machines that were exactly that they used, the same right?
Thing. Yeah. So like could this Godzilla take out any other Godzillas?
No. Oh, no. I don't think so. I think the other ones are more calculated and brutal, but Jimmy would probably be the one to go to on this one.
Any Godzilla can this Godzilla take out, or is it just this the Glass Jaw of Godzillas?
Maybe a Mothra.
This would definitely be considered the Glass Jaw. I mean, first of all, he doesn't really have any defense weapons as far. I mean, the others all have atomic breath. They can just, you know, vaporize them, nuke them.
True.
Yeah. Well, let's get into our next segment, Stop It, where we're each going to pick a good, a bad, and an ugly scene. I guess I'll kick mine off with my good scene, because there was a lot of faults with this scene too, but I did enjoy it. I liked the whole Madison Square Garden, like the egg, clearly alien references, but I did enjoy that scene. There was a lot wrong with it, but I thought it was a fun take on it, whether maybe it's just me really liking Alien and Jurassic Park, and they just kind of stole both of those, and I'm the sucker that fell for it. But I didn't borrow
the alien egg.
Stop counting.
Yeah, exactly. I didn't mind it. But Kevin, what's your good scene?
I agree, it's the Madison Square Garden thing, but specifically when they get to the broadcast booth and she's trying to get the guy in the production truck to go live, and she's going, put me live, and he's like, I'm not putting you live. And then Animal takes the camera and he pans it down to the garden with all the dinosaurs down there, and he's like, see this? And he's like, puts her on live.
I got you, you're live.
That panning scene where he pans down and shows the garden.
All right, Ed? Come on, huh?
Huh? You see that, Ed? They're going to be all over the city if we don't stop them.
Give me a second, will you?
Yeah, that's kind of what sold it for me, too. I like that aspect of it. Diaz, what's your one good scene for this?
You know what I like? It's kind of weird that I like this. I like the smarts of Godzilla. When they tried to fool him the second time, and he said, why would food just be sitting there like that? The fact that he kind of like showed smarts, he showed that he wasn't an idiot, which is kind of weird. You know, it shows some animals are intelligent creatures. We don't know if Godzilla is that intelligent or not, but I like how they made him smart. He dodged the torpedoes in the Hudson. He ran away from the military. He hid. I like the instincts they had Godzilla have.
Yeah. Sil, what was your good scene on this?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know why this movie did this to me. Because I don't like Godzilla itself, but there's some emotional connection with the monster. And like, you see it three times, you see it when like Nick sees it for the first time, that, you know, you kind of referred to it earlier, like you look at each other and you're like, oh, cool, they're going to be friends or whatever the fuck. But then, dude, when they explode Madison Square Garden, and then he comes out and looks down and all his kids are just dead. And he just,
when he's trying to wake up. I'll give you that.
why you gotta do that? Like, I don't know. Like, I that got me. And then yeah, even when
I shouldn't
it died,
be feeling this.
The way it dies, like they put
the heartbeat
music,
the heartbeat.
Nico's like, oh, this is the one that got away. You know, like he was just like into it. And I mean,
I like definitely pulled at the heartstrings there. And when you didn't, yeah, you weren't expecting so that in this
None
movie either
at all.
I forgot about the scene with him playing with his baby. Like,
oh man.
Yeah.
I also didn't see it. I thought the movie was over there too.
And I think
that's where it probably movie, should have ended.
The yeah heartbeat scene, somebody said, was a ripoff or whatever. Was there a Kong movie maybe that there's a movie that they said ended with that same kind of heartbeat scene that they pulled from? And I think I read it was a King Kong movie.
That would make sense. But Jimmy, what's your good scene that like the one scene for you?
My one scene is definitely his initial, I guess, assault on New York. I think that's incredible. I think Roland Emmerich, you know, as bad as this film is, I think Roland Emmerich does an excellent job setting Godzilla up, you know, with the initial attack on the fishing barge, or, you know, then the pulling the fishing boats down, and then the initial actually him coming to New York right through Fulton's Fish Market, stomping his way through. I love the, you know, I think the most iconic scene is him is animal getting wedged in between his toes. I think it's a great scene. I love the scene where the boats are all attached to his spine because he comes out of the pier, the harbor, and they're just dropping and they're falling. I love how he kind of blends in with the buildings around him too. He kind of becomes like a soft gray, and then at night kind of becomes like his spines end up changing too to like purplish blue. I thought it was a great setup. It's where he starts off as you think he's going to be malevolent. He's going to be, and then it kind of shifts to him curious looking at Nick. And that's kind of the problem I have, is he doesn't know where he wants to go with this character of Godzilla. Whether he wants him to be malevolent or benevolent.
And, yeah.
You know, but
he definitely dances.
Yeah.
He dances between the two too much, which doesn't work for Godzilla.
The initial assault or invasion of New York is awesome. I love that scene.
Yeah. Well, then let's get to the bad scenes, and I'll just fire it right back to you, Jimmy. Then what's the one bad scene for you?
The bad scene for me is kind of, it's almost like a collection. It's kind of like that I want to say like act two in the movie, where when Godzilla's out of the picture, you know, after the helicopter chase and stuff, and now it's just like the human element, and this entire time like the pharmacy's open, like why isn't anyone evacuate, like why isn't yeah this, why isn't New York cleared out? It's kind of, you know, what's Godzilla doing this whole time? You know, is he just under the under Madison Square Garden still laying eggs? It's kind of just a lull. You know, I feel like it's just an attempt to get to know the characters a little more. But that's kind of boring, or, you know, it kind of slows the story down a little bit.
Yeah, they could have shaved some minutes there. Still, yeah. what's if you had to pick one bad scene, what's one that really stands out?
It's rough. I think Audrey crying is just
awful. That was tough to watch.
That is just awful. Like, you don't even know how to feel. You don't even know if you should turn the TV off, or you don't know. Yeah, there's no connection. There's no, you know, she goes from being miserable to like jumping out of the window and going out. And like, I don't know. No connection the whole time, because I keep saying their love story is terrible. They keep playing this like Stuart Little songs every time they talk to each other, and it's like she's cringy.
We have absolutely no information whatsoever to make us believe that there are any eggs of the creature in the city. There's no need for panic. Repeat, there's no reason to panic.
No, it's It's all my fault.
Yeah, it was tough. And he's like, oh, well, what if there was a way you could save this and salvage this relationship? I followed him into the French headquarters, which I don't know how he knew they were all French, but sure. The right. soup, the and super
nobody
secret.
Can find them, but animal yeah. can sniff
croissants in the coffee.
Yeah, they can infiltrate the military, but they don't notice when a cameraman is tailing them.
Yeah. Sure.
Diaz, what's one bad scene for you?
The ending of the movie, man, in the garden before Godzilla comes back. The whole 20-minute scene of them fighting in the garden, home of the Knicks, fighting everywhere, multiple floors. They're running through doors. They're breaking through glass. They're not leaving the lobby. They're all in the lobby. Not one of these Godzillas broke through the glass doors in the lobby. Then, as they're shooting the stuff that the lights that are coming down on them, they're running away, but then coming back. And as they're running through the doors, they don't follow them through the doors.
Or there's eat them.
There's no way those Godzillas would have still been in the lobby. You mean they ran all through the garden just to hang out in the lobby?
Yeah.
Stop it.
Stop it. And then I got tickets.
Yeah, right. They're waiting for the game to start.
Yeah.
Kevin, what's the one bad scene that you got?
There's lots of scenes that I would be candidates because they went on too long or it was... Mm-hmm. I think the scene that sums up kind of the larger, I don't want to say problem, but the issue with the movie, the one of the scenes that somebody already mentioned where like the baby dinosaurs are all dead and Godzilla's like looking down at all his kids dying. And I'm like, this is supposed to be a monster movie where like he's the protagonist. He's killing all the people. You're like, let's kill that son of a bitch. And now I'm like, oh, the poor little guy. Yeah. Oh, that's terrible. Just let him go nest.
And it's funny, too, because I'm curious, who killed more people in this movie, Godzilla or the military? Because they were blowing buildings up like it was nobody. How many bystanders were just kind of in their living room watching TV and just got lit up by bullets from the helicopter?
And so I guess I'll ask again, Jimmy being the expert, are there other Godzilla movies where you're supposed to be sad that Godzilla dies at the end and you're like kind of choked up, poor guy died?
Yeah, he's definitely, it's funny because he's definitely a tragic character. He's this, you know, he's the son of the atomic bomb. So I remember, you know, the very first original one had a very somber ending. You know, they took this thing called, and that's where the human element comes in because there's a scientist, Dr. Sarazawa, who creates these oxygen destroyer, which dissolves anything, you know, within its range. And Dr. Sarazawa doesn't want it to fall into the wrong hands. So what he does is he goes down where Godzilla is sleeping and he's one of those diver suits. So he cuts his line and deploys the oxygen destroyer, taking himself and Godzilla out with him. And the movie just kind of ends there with everyone just taking their hats off on the boat and just, you know, in the.
So maybe that is a little bit in line with the spirit of the franchise.
Emotions.
Yeah, he's always been a tragic figure. You know, he's the result of what happens if you, you know, when man messes with nuclear weapons. He's man. You know, he's punishment. He's like a metaphor.
To me, the scene came away as like animal abuse. Like we.
Yeah,
this,
I mean,
you made this monster more like an animal, mm-hmm. and now right. we're killing its young.
Oh, right.
Maybe he should knock the whole city down.
I mean, Roland Emmerich definitely went with the more grounded approach. If this creature actually existed, you know, he'd probably be mutated from like a reptile, like a marine iguana.
So more indicative of how I think the story was off for me, not necessarily visually or how the scene was written.
Yeah.
I think my bad scene would be that second military attack. Them trying the same tactic they did before, except this time they're in Central Park. That's the only difference. But this time,
a bunch of guys just hiding behind a Jersey barrier with their long rifles, shooting at it again.
40 helicopters at the ready that are not using those flight patterns, that are not hitting each other, that are shooting just blindly.
Another thing, Nick, would our government actually want to kill it, or would it try to like sedate it
and use it as a weapon? They'd be keeping this thing.
I feel like they would sedate it.
Yeah. But yeah, it's that whole mill, and for two reasons, right? Like, realistically, like, are they going to try the same thing that just failed? And for a storytelling perspective, we just saw the same thing. Like, you're just reusing the scene twice, only with more. So that kind of goes to Roland Emmerich's like MO, where it's just like more and bigger and explosions. And I'm surprised, you know, if this movie was made in 2008, Michael Bay would have made this movie.
And another long one, right? I mean, they could have done some of this stuff in a lot less time.
Oh yeah. The one ugly scene, let's hit on these really quick. And these ones are the ugly scenes that just age like fine milk. They do not hold up. Who wants to kickstart off this one? Diaz, you want to kick off your ugly scene? Or it doesn't even have to be a scene. It could be a thing from the movie.
When Godzilla has the car in his mouth and he doesn't kill him, he's just nibbling on the car.
Bad.
Stop it.
And the car still drives. The car still drives.
Once they were in his mouth, that's over. That's death. They're not going to reach out the car to grab an electrical wire to shock Godzilla.
Modern version of Moby Dick.
Yeah, that's not working. That ugly scene, there's no way that car is driving. There's no way. They're dead.
Yeah. Syl, what's your ugly scene that just doesn't hold up? Doesn't make sense.
I mean, he kind of made me want to rethink what I had, because
there's just
ugly and hate, right? Like, I hated the entire soundtrack of the movie. All the songs that were played at wrong spots. And the soundtracks and spatial awareness of the aircraft in this movie is just awful. It doesn't age well. You can see them, like these two in that Panama shot when the choppers are going through to see the boat. There's no wind at the bottom. There's no there's no nothing. Just a shadow going in, and they just like turn around aggressively. Like, we're here for what? I don't know, but the choppers are here. And then what Kevin said, like the driving through the, flying through the buildings, through the city, and
right out of Star Wars.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah, those that doesn't age well, bro. Like, it doesn't.
No, Jimmy, what didn't age well for you out of this movie?
I think the whole baby Godzilla scene, you know, especially them going down the escalators into the main lobby of Madison Square Garden and just shooting down the lights and then backing away and then coming back at it, like, you know, instead of ripping, like they ripped the other French Foreign Legion people together, like ripped up, they just back away and then come back and then back away and come, and then they get locked in and then, you know, like die.
They could have easily killed. And the fact that they tripped on gumballs, just the most Benny Hill's Monty Python style slapstick. Because you got to throw it in there, right?
Doesn't at first feel like my MSG was underground?
But
then when they go and blow it up, it's like perfectly untouched.
You're right. You're right.
It's like, I thought this was buried already. Because like,
they business as usual. Knicks game kicks, you know, tips off.
They're like, tickets now around the fucking thing. And you're like, let's blow it up. We didn't have enough with the Chrysler building. Let's take something big again.
Let's get this one down. Kevin, what's the one ugly scene for you?
I think as far as what didn't age well, I think the portrayal of like the French guys, it was just bad.
You said this was French roast.
Ah oui, regardez. C'est marqué French roast.
It was just
like,
so
you could have, if you wanted to, okay, you want to blame the French for all the nuclear testing, like, okay, yeah, it was all their fault. Not sure why they picked the French to do it, but let's not make them the nuclear villains in it, and then also like make them ridiculously stereotypical.
Just keep on kicking them. They're the punching bag of this movie.
You call this coffee? This coffee.
Well, this is he comes up, he rolls up with like all the guns and missiles. They're like, well, this is in America. We can buy whatever we want. It's like, where the fuck are you buying that in New York? Like, you're not buying missiles and grenades and assault rifles in New York. Like, why are you all chewing gum? Because it looks more American.
Like, yeah. Sure. That did not work when I got my green card, by the way.
It's just chewing gum.
Yeah. Did you, you do put your it, Elvis?
You grabbed some chewing gum and you told him, thank you very much.
Yeah.
You got a problem talking?
Well, no, sir, I'm fine.
All right, keep it moving.
Well, thank you very much.
Here's my papers. Thank you very much.
My ugly scene or character that didn't hold up was just Victor's wife. Just the whole character of Victor's wife. So everything annoying. She says is terrible.
Along the same exact lines. They just overplayed it.
Yeah. They like I said, you could tell this was a 90s movie. You know, they let everything fly, but does not age well. Running solo award. This is where we kind of decide what's the one thing that won this movie for you. Maybe it didn't make the movie a winner, but you know, what was the shining point in this movie? Jimmy, I'm curious to see what like your number one thing that you could peg in this movie to being like a winner.
So this kind of carries off from Cell. I'm going to have to politely, respectfully disagree. I think David Arnold's score is incredible. I know it's like when you first see Godzilla and all, you know, all of his glory, you know, it is a little bit of Jurassic Park, but that opening title, seeing the nuke go off and just that like whiplash of as soon as the bomb goes off and then just drops that theme is incredible.
Big needle drop moment.
Yeah. And David Arnold has worked with Roland Emmerich before, especially, you know, he had a great score in Independence Day. I think I'd give it to David Arnold. I love the score of this movie. I think it's top notch as far as, you know, for any kind of kaiju or film.
I mean, again, another movie that we talked about, The Wedding Singer. I mean, this soundtrack was pretty, this was a very, very popular like soundtrack purchase of the time.
It went triple platinum.
Yeah, this was, I remember seeing the CD itself. I mean, also like with the end credits, you know, that I didn't like the song, but the whole Puff Daddy Led Zeppelin. I mean, that was a hit.
How about the Wallflowers, Heroes?
Yeah.
They did the cover. Yeah. You had Rage Against the Machine. Mm-hmm. No Shelter. What's the band called? Jamiroquai, yep. Or whatever.
Jamiroquai.
Deeper Underground. There was the Foo Fighters were even on that. So the soundtrack itself with the artists and stuff, very, very in times with the 90s.
I think Diddy goes up for not a Grammy or like some sort of award for that song. He didn't win it, but he was nominated for it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. The soundtrack ended up going, I think, like triple platinum, like exploded.
It was like a best of late 90s. Like rock songs, you know, very reminiscent to, and maybe because I just watched it, but you know, The Matrix, how that ends with Rage Against the Machine as well. Like that title card hits, and they're just like, bang, here you go. Here's some like pseudo industrial heavy rock, and just kind of they know the audience. Syl, what is the one thing that, if you can find one thing, what's the one thing that you can pick out that won it for you?
I don't know, because I guess. I kept coming back and watching it, right? So it's not like I'm allergic to the movie.
It's a guilty pleasure,
right? Like I don't know. I am
still takes a pass.
I might take it back. Like I can go back to the emotion of the creature, like the animal thing, but I feel like that was not the goal of the movie. So like, why would that be? That didn't necessarily make it for me. Like, if anything, thank you for introducing me into the monster verse.
Right.
Know, even if
it's
even
only if up it's from not, here, I promise you.
Right. Like, I watched it, made me watch 2014, and I was like, bro, this is amazing.
Yes. Amazing. That, and whenever they release, and Jimmy might be able to jump in on this more than I, because I don't think there's a release date yet, but for the newest Godzilla Minus One was one of the best movies I've seen this year. The story was phenomenal. Godzilla was looking great. I mean, it won an Oscar. You know, it won Oscar for best visual effects. It's, you know, so this is unfortunately the bottom of the barrel for the Godzilla right. movies. But like you said, that 2014 one, like that whole series, this new MonsterVerse is they're good movies. And it's not just Godzilla for the sake of Godzilla. It's actually a good movie with Godzilla there.
Right.
So maybe there's what's won it for you. The introduction. What won it.
It let me, you know, get into the MonsterVerse and just because I really enjoyed 2014 and I have Kong Skull Island on pause.
Nice. Yeah, I'm very curious to see your thoughts because they do get really good and I'm excited. I have tickets to go see Godzilla Kong tomorrow, so or Thursday. But either way, Diaz, what's the one thing that won this for you?
Nothing. What I like about that, let me explain. What I liked about this is kind of like what Sil said. It introduced him to other ones. What I liked about this is it showed him everything not to do for future Godzilla movies. So this paved the way to everything great we have now. It's not that this is a terrible movie. It was a terribly done movie. Like there was a lot of potential with this movie and it made money. It made you. I saw it. I saw it again, and we're doing a podcast on it. So obviously, it's a good enough movie to examine, and it just opened the door. It made Toho want to do more, and it made other directors go, "I can do that better." Right. So the best thing about this movie is that it wasn't what anyone wanted. What it didn't do, it opened the door for such great stuff to come, and all the stuff has been great. So
you can't enjoy the sunny days without a couple rainy ones. So.
Or 95 minutes. Oh, I mean, 95% of a movie.
Of just rain. Kevin, what's the one thing that won it for you?
I saw a lot of people that reviewed this movie and said the same thing, that like Matthew Broderick was totally miscast and he shouldn't have been in a Godzilla movie and he shouldn't have played this part. I think out of all the thin characters that are in this human side of the storyline, I liked him as well as probably any actor in that role. And there was some bad acting. The script was a draft and the plot line was really thin as far as the little bit of the storyline, the little rom-com side storyline that was mixed in there. I had no problem with him. I think he played that goofy scientist part perfect. So I was fine with him in this.
I don't know what people had expected him to do more with that role, right? Because like you said, it was
a common thing that they were like, oh, that it should have never been a Matthew Broderick movie. Like
well, you know what, maybe the lead shouldn't have been a worm detective. How about that? That goes down to script and story writing, not the actual actor portraying that character.
And I think what he did with what I would consider a pretty thin script, I think he delivered as much as you could squeeze out of that role.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the one thing that I put as the winner is kind of like a half winner, right? Like I think, let's talk about Roland Emmerich, right? At the time, this was the right guy to get, you know, it's just that monster explosion, big budget kind of thing.
Right off of Independence Day, right?
Yeah. He went a little in the wrong direction, but I think it was the right move trying to get him involved. Now you probably should have reined him in a little bit and, you know, the Toho and everybody should have been like, no, dude, like you don't get free reign. Like this is our creature. You have to abide by our rules. But I do think that he was the right guy. I just don't think he executed it properly, but I give him the nod for doing his thing. You know, you bring this guy in for a reason, you know what his track record is. And he made you a bunch of money at the box office.
He can destroy cities, man. He destroys stuff. Great.
Yeah,
and so, I guess it's hindsight too, right? Like he could have done this very unique twist, veered way off of what the franchise was, and it worked. Hits it out of the park. Genius. Mm-hmm. The guy's a genius, right?
Yeah,
it could have went either way.
So I give him the nod.
Didn't have the terrible characters, bad acting, and the script that was shitty. But other than that, they could have hit it out of the park.
What if he was a fan of the franchise? I mean, we could be talking about a totally different movie.
Right? The MonsterVerse would have started then.
I think the charge that he didn't take it seriously and wasn't into this. I think when I read about what he did with Siskel and Ebert, told me he didn't take it serious. Because we haven't talked about it yet, but
yeah,
he had an axe to grind with Siskel and Ebert, the critics, right? Which is why there's Mayor Ebert in this movie, right? He was given a dig to Roger Ebert, the film critic. So if you don't know this, the Mayor Ebert in this movie looks just like Roger Ebert.
Ladies and gentlemen, the man you've all been waiting for, yours for a safer New York, your mayor, Mayor Ebert!
Thank you! Thank you!
He's just this useless, dumb character.
And so Siskel and Ebert, who like review movies, you know, they do the thumb up, thumb down. Well, the mayor in this movie, his campaign was thumbs up for New York or whatever, right? And his aide is named Gene. And that's Gene Siskel. It just looks like the two of them. And then even at the end of the movie, when his guy Gene like gets fed up and leaves, and he's like, you know what I think of your campaign? Thumb down. Like, so if you put that much effort into like, I'm going to write these two characters into it and just dig you with your ups and downs, and like, maybe you're not taking the project seriously.
No, that's, he had an axe to grind.
But that's fine. But still,
is
that really where your creative energy should be?
Yeah, still deliver.
You know? And then like Siskel and Ebert responded like after the movie, and they're like, well, at least you could have. I mean, if you were so upset with us about that, you could have at least had the monster eat us or stomp us or kill us.
Do something good. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No. All right, let's hit our little time machine time here. We're going to kind of take this movie and warp it through the years and adjust it to a little bit of a I don't want to say better, but our own individual takes. This is where we're going to cast forward. We are going to each present to you a director and some characters. Typically in the past, we've recasted characters as actual characters, but this one we felt it would be better to, instead of recasting Nick Tatopoulos or whatever, you know, we're just going to give you generic characters. So I'll give you mine and then we can kind of go from there. But in my movie, this would be a very super meta movie where Godzilla exists more out of not like folklore, but Godzilla, the movie character, exists. And people just don't think it's real and it's just a movie. And then he shows up. But I'm going to have Matt Reeves direct this, known for, you know, most recently the Batman series. My lead scientist, and this movie is pretty much cast from superhero world, essentially. So Matt Reeves from the Batman. But my lead scientist is Letitia Wright, Shuri from Black Panther. She nails the scientist role right there. The military lead I'm going to go with would be Michael Shannon, who you've known from Knives Out, a bunch of other stuff. The mayor, I'm going to cast Robert Downey Jr. coming off of his Oppenheimer win recently. He obviously can play that kind of dickhead strict character, which strays a little bit from the path that he normally had. My second lead is going to be a Godzilla super fan, Paul Rudd. He's going to be that quirky kind of guy, just similar to how he is in the new Ghostbusters movie where he was a fan of the Ghostbusters. He's going to kind of be putting his two cents in as the Godzilla nerd. And then your villain, you're sort of like French. You don't know if he's good or bad. Is going to be Ben Kingsley. Kind of fits that role of like that weird, I don't know if I trust this guy or not. But who wants to put up their cast forward?
Ben Kingsley. That's good.
Take it, Sil.
All right. So you mentioned my director early on, but I did have Michael Bay directing this new movie of Godzilla. Yep. And I didn't go necessarily full on superhero here, but for Nick Tatopoulos, I got Mark Ruffalo.
It's Tatopoulos. Yeah, whatever.
Tatopoulos. Yeah, whatever.
Mark Ruffalo? Okay. Yeah,
Mark Ruffalo would definitely take on the lead in this movie for me. And I think he wouldn't be as quirky. He'll be more like straightforward. Like, this is what I do, you know, play on that scientific role. I casted Audrey. definitely new lines, but I'm actually going to go with Dakota Johnson from Madame Web. I think she'll play
50 better. Shades of Godzilla.
50 Shades of Race. So the villain guy, Liam Neeson, would be my French guy.
Okay. The Irish were in charge of the nuclear tests in this movie.
Yeah, there you go. Well, the mayor, I have John Lovitz as the mayor. Okay. That's why I asked about him earlier. Colonel Hicks, I think we there's a guy, Glenn Morshower. He's in the movie, like at the beginning of the show. Mm-hmm. I think he should play. He plays a really good, like, military strategist type of guy. So, and I have David Asmalchin as Animal.
Okay.
So,
that's a good one. That's, I like that. I like Mark Ruffalo leading that. I like how we both went MCU scientists.
Yeah. And
you got Shuri and Bruce Banner.
That's true. For Animal is the, you know, the guy from Ant-Man, the Baba Yaga.
Oh yeah, the polka dot man from the Suicide Squad.
Yeah,
and, he's in Late Night with the Devil currently right now.
Yeah, that would be my Animal.
I like that. That's a good cast because he's got some good acting chops. All right, who's stepping up to the plate next?
That was great. That was classic.
You want me to go or you want to go?
You're the Godzilla guy. Go, man. Go.
So awesome. My main character for a scientist would be Daniel Radcliffe.
Wow.
Harry Potter. My army guy would be, oh boy, there's a bunch of choices here. I'd go Saving Private Ryan. I'd go Ed Burns. You know,
okay.
Ed Burns.
He might know more military lingo than the people in this movie.
My camera guy would definitely be JB Smoove from Pootie Tang. Tang and Curb Your Enthusiasm. I would take it back to the Japanese roots. So for my agent, I guess, or, you know, a guy that's trying to correct his mistakes or the mistakes of his people would be, I can't pronounce this, for Hiroki Sanada. You know, the guy from who played Scorpion in Mortal Kombat.
Oh, okay.
Bullet Train. He plays the grandfather.
The Elder. Yep.
The Elder. He's also in that quick scene with an Endgame with Ronin, or the head of the Yakuza. So that's who I'd pick.
I almost put him in there too.
Yeah.
Because I just watched Bullet Train the other day and I was like, mind.
So did I.
Diaz, who do you got for your cast forward?
It's funny. You guys went Marvel. I went Game of Thrones all day.
Ooh. Oh, I forgot my director. Sorry. Hit me with the director. My bad. J.J. Abrams.
Okay.
Yeah.
I had a list of three directors. Both Michael Bay, J.J. was on there. I'm going to go with David Ayer.
Okay.
From Training Day, from all those Grounded movies, some drama, some action. And I literally went Game of Thrones style on this. My male lead, give me Robert Madden. Give me Rob Stark, baby.
Okay.
My Audrey, or my female lead, would be the actress that played Cersei on that.
Lena,
yes, that would be my female lead. And she'd have more of a big role in it. It would be more of a power dynamic with her.
I figured you were going to say Sophie Turner. Sansa.
I was gonna but I want Cersei because I want her to
compete. What's the other one? Elite. Emily Clark, is that the other one, or am I making that name up?
Emily Clark. My villain would be Littlefinger, the guy that plays Ida Littlefinger, which is Adrian Gillen. He would be my villainous bad guy. My army guy would be the guy that played Tormund Redbane. The I think it's Christoph something. I don't know how to pronounce his name. The guy that played the Jon Snow's best friend.
Yeah, he's like Swedish.
Yeah, Chris. He was in a game. He was in a Fast and Furious too. Christopher Hivju or something like that.
Okay. Or
Giant Spin.
Yeah, him. That would be my army guy, my soldier, my rough, rugged soldier, and my mayor. I'm going comedic. Give me George Costanza. Give me Jason Alexander. He's my mayor of New York. George Costanza as George Costanza, basically. That would be my mayor. But yeah, I went Game of Thrones all through it out.
What's the deal with all these lizards?
You just blew up the Chrysler building.
Kevin, who do you have cast forward?
Okay, so I did something a little different here. I went with what I guess you could call a cast swap.
Okay.
I said, I'm going to take a cast from a different movie, and I have to recast them into this movie.
I like that.
Let me see if
this Roadhouse. Works.
Oppenheimer.
Oh, okay.
So I would, as the scientist, Matt Damon.
Okay.
As Animal, the camera guy, Cillian Murphy.
Okay. Okay.
Emily Blunt is Audrey.
Way better Audrey.
Robert Downey Jr. is Cayman, the business guy, or the newscaster guy. Jason Clark is Colonel Hicks. Scott Grimes is Sergeant O'Neill. And Tony Goldwyn is the Felipe, the French Secret Service guy.
Mm-hmm.
So I just like that. Swapped the casts.
Not bad.
I like that.
That's
because I had Downey Jr. in mind, too. It's a good cast right there. So while we're in the time machine, let's time warp this thing. You know, obviously, we don't need to see what these characters are up to today. So let's adjust this a little bit. How does a Godzilla attack look today in modern New York City? There's a lot of changes from... Yeah, a lot of these movies, other than the most recent one, are not present day for us anymore. You know, 98 was, it feels like an eternity ago. There's so much different nowadays. So how would this look today? So let's go to our New York expert first, and let's see, what's it look like today in New York?
There's no chance Godzilla would make it out the river. It would be because of everything, you know, that happened with 9/11, the military's on standby in New York. The second anything is in that water, any type of threat, our military would take it out with the quickness. It wouldn't even be a fair fight. Godzilla would be destroyed quickly because of all the stuff that happened in New York. Another city, maybe a chance. New York,
no.
The government's too close. They're ready. They're ready for anything.
Jimmy, what do you think happens today in a modern Godzilla attack?
I think there's a lot more deaths because everyone's just going to stop and take out their phones to film. And that way, he's just going to step on everybody, crush everybody, you know. So I think there'll be a lot more casualties.
Yeah, I'll kind of tack on to that, too, because that was similar in my mindset where I was like, this has Logan Paul and TikTok stars written all over it. They are going to be out there in the streets just to gain viewers. And then this would be immediately all over Twitter. But then people would be fighting with each other over the internet, debating if this is real or not, or if this was some government staged event. And it would just collapse society. And you still, at the end of the day, probably wouldn't know if this was real or not. You'd have all the Godzilla truthers out there saying that this was all staged and
where's AI the body? You mean to tell me there's no body, no flesh, no.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Nope. Nobody would take this thing serious, and it would just desecrate it. Phil, what do you think?
Yeah, it's like a mixture of what you said and Jimmy said. I think they'll bring BLM back here. They'll bring it back. Big listeners matter. Yeah. it'll definitely be a social warp. There'll be like the lizard crawl dance on TikTok, and
they'd be out in droves with the signs. You know, he can't speak, so we speak for him.
Right? Yeah, the whole asexual campaign. It'll be.
Godzilla intense. Pregnancy tests being handed out.
For sure.
Even though he would just stomp on them and just crush every little community possible because he doesn't care. Because he's a lizard. Kevin, what happens today in a modern world attack of Godzilla?
They would have to just tie in some current affairs. And of course, he has to crush Trump Tower, right? And then there's a news clip where Trump's talking about his buildings wrecked. He's like,
I always call it massive. Sometimes they say huge.
Huge. Huge lizard. All right. This movie has been made in a bunch of different ways. Prequels, everything. Sequels. But we're going to... What's the best option for this movie moving forward? Prequel, sequel, requel, remake, spinoff, pass. We have so many other instances of this movie making its way back into cinematic history. So, Jimmy, I'm curious to see what you think would be an interesting take for Godzilla moving forward.
Well, for this movie, what I would have done, I would probably scrap the name Godzilla. And within that intro, you know, where the nuclear bomb goes off, you have like a really cool movie in itself right there. Like, what if all of the reptiles mutated? And now it's a huge kaiju film of just all of these different type of reptiles, Komodo dragons, marine iguanas, you know, regular lizards just roaming the earth, destroying, you know, city, like huge landmarks and cities. And, you know, it's a takeover I think that could be a really cool
to that not making it Godzilla thought. I mean, a lot of people refer to this or him, the monster in this, as Gino.
Or Gino, yep.
Yeah.
And a Godzilla lot of fans
in Godzilla in name only.
So. And the characters now known as, to differentiate the two, Zilla. You know.
Because interesting. Kind of a
got out of it.
Mixture of Godzilla and Planet of the Apes situation.
Yeah. I think that would have been really cool.
So honest. They took the god out of it? Respect.
So what are you doing with this? Like, where would you like to see Godzilla next? You know, saying we don't have the stuff we have today.
Wait, where do I want to see it next?
Like, what would you do with this movie? Like a Godzilla movie?
No other movies have come out. Just this 98 version. Just the version you saw.
Gotcha. I mean, I think a remake would be, because what Jimmy said was literally, I wrote down literally just call it something different. And then you can even make it part of a Monsterverse. So it's like some other creature than Godzilla. You know, just, it could even team up with the actual Godzilla as, you know.
Well, that's the thing. Robin. People love the design of the creature. Because it is a cool. Very cool looking animal or monster. You know, I'm just one of those that, you know, if it's Godzilla, it's Godzilla. I know I'm going to get trash for that one, but, and it's a nostalgic thing for me too. I mean, I saw this when I was a kid, but you know, I think to make everyone happy, what you would do, because a lot of fans want Zilla in the Monsterverse. A lot of fans want to see him. It's kind of like one of those things where, you know, like when we saw like No Way Home. You know, Andrew Garfield got that huge pop, but his movies weren't that great. His Amazing Spider-Man movies kind of weren't great, but he got that huge pop after so many years. When Hayden Christensen came back after so many years with Obi-Wan, you know, fans truly like were, you know, it was the nostalgic feeling. I think if you put him in the Monsterverse in some capacity, even just making him a subspecies, like a cousin. So that way he's part of, he's not Godzilla, but he's in the Godzilla family. I think that could make everyone happy. I mean,
Diaz, what are you doing with Godzilla?
I would make a sequel to this, but it wouldn't be like anything. It wouldn't be anything really to do with this movie. It would be the future. You know how in the beginning of this movie, they showed the past and the bombs and everything that kind of made Godzilla? The intro for the next one would show clips of all the army failing to stop him. And that one egg hatching and making millions of them, like hundreds and thousands, kind of like a Planet of the Apes, but you see other creatures as well. The humans are very small survivors, maybe like a few hundred thousand, like in the whole world, there's not that many humans. Mm-hmm. There's nothing but these big creatures everywhere. Big rodents, like a giant ass rat fighting this Godzilla. Another ape, obviously. A big ass bird. Like all the animals that were affected are now taking over the world. We're the dying species. It would just be cool to see the animals take over the world and give the animals. You saw the humane part of that Godzilla when his babies died out. He was trying to wake them up. That hurt him. So in this new world, Godzilla kind of basically will be like Planet of the Apes. They're not talking.
Yeah.
None of them are talking. But literally, they're the main species, the Godzilla. Or the Zillas or whatever. They're the species. But there's animals everywhere just like them. So
it's just animals. Who's going to film it?
Oh, no. There's still people. There's not a lot. They're trying to take the world back. And they're trying to create shit. But there's not a lot of them left.
Yeah. Kevin, what's your Godzilla movie looking like? Or series or whatever?
I think it's a sequel just for a second chance to get it right. And for me, that... So you talked about the scene where he was in the big footprint when he realizes I'm in a footprint. I like that scene. And it's because I thought we were going to get more of the, and it's very Jurassic Park-like. I thought we were going to get more of like, how did this happen? So if it was a movie that did a sequel based on maybe because the egg, the end of it, right? The egg is still there and Broderick has to play the same guy. And now they've got to go find the origins to figure out how they can defeat this thing. Back to the jungle, back, make it more scientific, kind of like analyzing how did this happen in the jungles, DNA, more research. I don't
it need has to be
I don't need too. I don't need to see any more buildings in New York knocked down. I don't need to see any more taxi crashing races and stuff. But
yeah,
well, I would funny. Take oh my no. bad, sorry. No, well, that's funny because they're so this was supposed to be a trilogy. And obviously it bombed, you know, the ratings were terrible, and so they did kind of come out with a soft sequel with the animated television show on Fox Kids, which was actually really popular. And they gave, you know, they carried off with the one egg, and Nick finds it and the baby imprints on Nick. So they kind of restored all of his powers back. They, you know, they gave him atomic breath. He fights other kaiju. He's stronger. He's so it kind of became like a soft sequel to the movie, and it was actually a really popular show for like 2 years on Fox Kids.
Yeah, so when they moved it back closer to what the origins were.
Right. Yeah. They kept the same design, obviously, but they gave him his like regenerative power, you know, it made him stronger. They gave him the atomic breath. He fought really cool monsters that some of them are based on in the MonsterVerse, you know. Mm.
Well, what I would do with this is I would give it almost like the Logan treatment, Logan being Wolverine, where I would make it almost like a dying Godzilla story where like he's lived his life. He's, you know, like we said in this movie, he's not really out to attack. He just doesn't have a place to live. So I would sort of have this kind of tragic story of old Godzilla, like kind of on its last breath, and humanity is like trying to hunt him again, even though he hasn't really done anything. And it's just like, it's kind of his like one last breath where like, come on, man, I thought we were good. And then I start attacking him, and then he's just like, all right, that's it. And then he just kind of goes in, destroys their like humanity, and you know, don't poke the bear, essentially.
See Godzilla vs. Destroya, where he is dying.
But let's get into our scale rating real quick before we sign off. So this is our popcorn scale from one being burnt to 5 being that perfect golden buttery popcorn. Where is this movie for you, Kevin? What is your popcorn scale rating for this movie?
It gets 2 kernels.
Okay. Diaz?
1.5. I don't like it. But all right. It gets the 0.5 because that fucking soundtrack was great.
Sil, what's this for you?
I'm there at 1.5.
1.5. I'm with Kevin. I gave this a 2 out of 5. And I saved Jimmy for last because I'm really curious. Because I know he doesn't love this movie, but I know he loves Godzilla. So I can see the torment the wheels in are his turning. Eyes.
Yeah, so nostalgic Jim wants to give it like, you know, 3. Objectively though, I'll give it's 2. It's a fun popcorn guilty pleasure movie, you know, for those that do like it. It's a, you know, you don't want to admit to your friends that it's that you like it, but it's fun. I think for what it is, I think it's just a fun film. I think it's mindless entertainment, and it's got a giant monster in it. Can't go wrong.
Listen, I'm with you, Jimmy. I understand your love for it, because that's how I am with anything Michael Myers related. Any Halloween movie, do it. It's some yeah, of
I'll
them
still watch it.
Yep. Garbage.
I love them all.
I'm there, baby.
I love them all.
Yeah,
all
right. H2O.
The downside was for the quality, it just went on too long. Like yeah. If you could have got through this thing in an hour, it would have been, oh, that's okay. I can take an hour of it. But
that's what's so weird, because I love our MonsterVerse Godzilla design. I think they kept how they updated him, but kept the spirit of like Godzilla. I think they did an incredible job with the MonsterVerse. The 2014 one is, to me, a slow burn. I think this one's a little faster. For me, I think it's a little more
fast, but it's too long. That's the thing. Yeah. Like they should have trimmed 20 minutes off this and it's perfect. You know, not perfect, but like, you know, you could lose 20 minutes and still not, you know, the story would still remain get it the too. Same. Yeah. Right.
And because it wasn't like a lot of scenes, like the getting out of the Madison Square Gardens took too long.
Yeah.
The taxi ride took too long.
Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like the MonsterVerse human elements, they're not that, like Kyle Chandler's characters is not that interesting. Millie Bobby Brown, I don't think's that great. The two most interesting characters that had that connection to Godzilla or the Titans, I guess, of that's what they're called in the MonsterVerse.
Cranston and
they killed them
Aaron
off.
Taylor.
And Ken Watanabe. He's the lead.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, like Aaron Taylor Johnson and Elizabeth Olsen weren't really memorable or great in those films. I think I agree with Kevin. I think Matthew Broderick's great as the core. Like, I think for a Godzilla film, you need like a scientist. You need that's the kind of guy that you need to lead these films. Someone that wants to study and forms that connection with the monster.
No, definitely. All right, well, let's send this movie back to 1998 and begin our reprogramming of the popcorn time machine. We will see you all next time with another blast from the past. And remember to be kind and rewind. We will see you next time.
Yeah.